decided to flood the Senate with amendments to this package of House fixes. The problem is that when you combine futility with desperate showiness, you tend to get awkward results. Case in point, it's time for the Republicans' last stand against health reform now, right? They want all eyes on them. It's time to unleash the amendments. They really want to be seen doing this. So who among them leads the charge at this critical moment when they want the nation's attention on them as they demonstrate their continued opposition to health reform, even in the face of certain defeat? Who is first up for the Republicans in this moment in the sun?
This fight is not over by a long shot. I'll be on the floor regularly all this week fighting the separate reconciliation bill.
I can't tell you how happy Democrats are about that. For some reason, it's Senator David Vitter of Louisiana and D.C. Madam Phone List fame who has been given the privilege of introducing the first two symbolic Republican stall tactic show-off amendments to the reconciliation package. One of them is a repeal the bill thing, which, of course, in the near term would mean letting insurance companies deny kids health coverage because of pre-existing conditions. Good luck selling that one. The other amendment that Senator Vitter introduced was about ACORN. Seriously, that was the second amendment. It's the second amendment he introduced. It's an amendment aimed at prohibition on funding for ACORN, which you might have heard doesn't really exist anymore. So that's the Republicans' big high-profile rollout of their last-ditch anti-health reform strategy. That's what they want America to see them doing because they think it makes them look great. Senator Vitter, lead the way against ACORN or whatever. Joining us now is Senator Amy Klobuchar, Democrat of Minnesota. Senator Klobuchar, it's very nice to have you back on the program. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you, Rachel. I did want to report, what was it that you called us, that I am live from Dysfunction Junction? That was really nice, a nice way to introduce me. Thank you.
Do you deny that the Senate is where legislation goes to die now?
Could I point out that in the last month we passed that major jobs package, remember, actually with some bipartisan support. We got the FAA reauthorization passed, which may sound small, which is actually a big deal for getting our air traffic modernized. So we're starting to get some things done here in a big way, and you will see a big thing this week with health care. As you pointed out, they are going to delay and obstruct every step of the way. You can call it the voter-rama drama. It will be going on into the night, but our people, despite what you may poke fun at us, we will not waver and we will get it done. You saw this in December when we got every single one of us together to vote for that bill. And you can't actually say that about the House, but Harry Reid, Dick Durbin, our leadership were able to unite our caucus on that bill. And you're going to see that again as we go forward. And we're going to be hit with some very difficult amendments. But the most important thing is to get health care done for the people of this country. I was just looking at our letters in the office to kind of get me going and inspire me for this week. And the one that always sticks out for me is a woman who wrote from Bemidji, Minnesota, named Sherry, and she was writing for her daughter, Mickey. And she said, Mickey just called me. In her words, she said, Mickey was sobbing so hard, I couldn't hear what she said. She said her husband's company just cut them off of their health insurance. It's a small business. They couldn't afford it. She said, and here's the deal. She said, my daughter, Mickey, has cystic fibrosis, and she won't be able to get insurance anymore. And then she said, she's been fighting her whole life, and we need someone to fight for her. We need to get this done. And so all of us that go to the floor this week that have to vote on these just horrific amendments that are just meant to really hurt us politically, are meant to delay things, are going to have one thing for our guiding light, and that's the people of this country that need health care, but also people who have health care that see it getting astronomically more costly and want to get these costs under control and make it more affordable, something in Minnesota that has been my major focus from the beginning on this bill. And as you know, half the bill is about cost control, and it reduces the deficit by $130 billion in the first 10 years, and that's what we'll be focused on.
Senator, let me ask you about one. It's not altogether procedural. It's about whether or not these fixes are actually going to pass. I know the idea originally was that the Senate would pass the House fixes exactly as is. So after the Senate vote, health reform would go to the president and really and truly be done, including this package that's still pending. Senator Baucus said today there might be a few changes to the reconciliation package in the Senate. That would mean it would have to go back to the House again, which opens up a whole nother can of worms, takes this out for longer, and also opens it up to more of these Republican delaying tactics in both houses. Do you think that'll happen, and are you worried about that?
You always have to worry about that, but really the hope here is to not have that happen, to pass this bill pure. We have made some major fixes in this bill that needed to be made. From the left to the right, people agree that Nebraska deal should get out of there, and that is what one of the major fixes is to extend those same benefits to the people of this country. Some of the changes to the excise tax and some other things that were necessary to be made. So from the Senate perspective, we're simply taking a bill that has some very good things in it, and making it better, making these improvements, fixing the bill, and that's what reconciliation is about. And as you have so beautifully done on your program many times, pointed out, reconciliation is something that's been used 22 times, 16 times by Republican Congresses, and it just gives you an ability to fix a bill.
Senator Amy Klobuchar of Minnesota, thank you for your time tonight. It's been too long since we've had you on the show, and I promise not to use the dysfunction junction thing next time.
It was a nice rhyme, I have to tell you.
See you soon, Rachel. I'll use the Votorama one next time, okay?
Yeah, I gave you one, Votorama drama.
Fair deal. Thank you, Senator.
Bye.
Okay, super conservative Texas Congressman Louis Gohmert is famous in the Rachel Maddow Show offices because he's the guy who once made an overt toilet joke about the health reform bill. We like bathroom humor. But the good congressman has one-upped even himself now. That's next. When Congressman You Lie Joe Wilson screamed at President Obama during a joint address to Congress last year, what did you think the effect of that outburst would be on Joe Wilson's career? Congressman Wilson's outburst was roundly criticized by everyone in mainstream politics, but on the far right, Joe Wilson became a hero. He became a hero for screaming at the president during a joint congressional session from the floor of Congress. And that lesson apparently has not gone unnoticed by the latest very conservative member of Congress to have shrieked out an epithet at the top of his lungs in the middle of someone else's speech in Congress. This time it's Texas Republican Congressman Randy Neugebauer, who now admits that it was he who screamed the words baby killer at Congressman Bart Stupak during the House votes on health reform on Sunday night.
Those who are shouting out are out of order.
Common wisdom holds that the person who screamed baby killer in Congress would look back on the incident with regret, that he or she would be embarrassed. That common wisdom would be totally wrong. Congressman Neugebauer now looking back on that incident and trying to use it to raise money for himself.
Hello, I'm Randy Neugebauer, and this is my wife, Dana. Last night, a very historic vote took place on the floor of the House of Representatives. Not only did we see the government take over your health care, but we saw the lives of unborn children used as a bargaining chip to somehow get the needed votes to pass this legislation. I spoke very passionately because I believed what was going on was not right for America. You know what? I'm never going to quit speaking on behalf of the unborn. I'm never going to quit speaking on behalf of the people of Texas and the people of the United States of America that find this policy unacceptable. And I will continue to speak with the same passion that I spoke last night, maybe in a little bit different form, but still with the same intensity. I want to thank you for the tremendous outpouring of support, but more importantly, I want to thank you for the opportunity and honor of representing you in the United States Congress.
I'm Randy Neugebauer, and if you want more screaming baby killer on the House floor, you can donate right here. Oh, and also, I'm really sorry for the screaming. But Congressman, vote for me. I'm screaming baby killer on the House floor. Randy Neugebauer is not the only member of the Texas congressional delegation who's making news today. There's also Louis Gohmert. Louis Gohmert is the congressman genius enough to combine his vitriolic fervor against health reform with the theme of a deservedly very popular children's book. It's hard to make health reform fit the plot of this book, but if anyone can do it, Louis Gohmert can.
This should not be passed by anyone unless they eat it. If they eat it, then I'm in favor of them passing it. Otherwise, don't pass it.
To recap, if you eat it, you can pass it. Took me all day to practice saying that without turning as beet red as I am right now and losing my composure. Since his go-ahead, eat-it-then-pass-it contribution to the health reform debate, Mr. Gohmert has decided that the democratically elected Senate voting for health reform is the actual problem. His proposed solution is that we don't democratically elect senators anymore. Louis Gohmert is proposing now to repeal the 17th Amendment to the Constitution, so state legislatures would just pick senators from here on out instead of letting the regular citizen riffraff in the states choose their own senators by voting.
The 17th Amendment took out the last check and balance on usurpation of states' rights. It's time to get the balance back in place. We have 39 states upset wanting to do something and not have another unfunded federal mandate coming down their throats. This will do it. Let's get an amendment that gets the balance back into the country and the Constitution before this Congress destroys what's left.